Bonjour et bienvenue dans ce nouvel épisode de Meet & Funk. Aujourd'hui, nous avons eu l'honneur de rencontrer Hubert Eves et D-Train. Nous avons parlé musique et nous avons parlé funk. Je vous laisse avec l'interview. So just excuse me for my English.
It's
not
no
the
worries.
Best English.
It's okay.
With a French accent.
You should hear my French.
So I will do my best for you to understand what I say. So thank you, Gen Z Trend, to be here. And Hubert Eves, I'm really happy to have you here on Beat and Funk and to talk about funk and funk music. And the first thing is, what was your first contact with the music?
My first contact with music was in the church. It was gospel music. Ronnie Dyson was my choir director, and he had a hit record called If You Let Me Make Love to You, Then Why Can't I Touch You? And I wanted to be like Ronnie Dyson, so that was my first connection to the music industry, the outside music industry, other than different church singers like Reverend Timothy Wright, Reverend Albert Jameson. Most of my connections, James Cleveland was in the church.
Coming up as a young player in my teens, playing in blues clubs. As I got into blues, the more I got into it, I started going into jazz and of course, gospel. I came up I was exposed to gospel first, but I'd never played in church. But I had a piano player that inspired me, who Carl Walker is his name, who used to play at our church. But like I said, after that I went into the blues and then jazz and dance music, funk and R&B and everything else.
So how was the project D-Train created? How did it started?
We came together on a session with an old high school classmate of mine, Will Downing, who's a great singer in his own right. They call him the king of sophisticated soul in jazz. That's his new title. He was doing a session on a song called The Real Deal. And so he wanted me to come in and sing background vocals for his project at a studio in Brooklyn called Sound Lab Studios, which was my first time in a professional sound recording studio. And in the middle of the session, Hubert came in because he was the producer. And before he came, Will says, he's with Roberta Flack, he's with all these other people. And he did the buildup. He's like, he's famous, he's very famous, D. So make sure you sing the song right. Yeah. And I said, okay, I'll sing it as best I can. So he was eating Chinese food. And Will asked me to do some ad-libs. And he's eating his food, and I started going, whoa, whoa. He said, wait a minute. He put the Chinese food down and really started to listen. And then after the session, I got his telephone number, and I went to his house the next day, and we started writing You're the One for Me.
And it was the first track?
Yeah, very first track. I went to his house, and he had the track up, and it was... And he said, I was riding up on the cloud and shout out loud. And he was like, this is all I got, man. I can't think of anything else. What do you got? What you got? I said, give me a pad.
Quick.
Yeah, so he gave me a pad and I started writing, with this new love I found. Takes love. So, you know, right then, the chemistry came together.
It was really quick?
Very quick.
To do this song?
Very quick.
And the album, how did it go did this album?
Well, that was the first song. It was a demo. We did three songs. I was shopping it around to different radio record companies. And the record companies, some of them said they loved it. They always loved it, but they always had a comment. We'd like to have that song for our artists. Can you take the singer off? No. Things like that. So or there was always some kind of catch to it. So we ended up saying no, and Prelude Records heard it. They were the ones that heard it to the point where they were like, in fact, there was a guy named Francois. He fell in love with it. He was like, this is a smash. This is it. So that's how we got connected with Prelude, through Francois, because of his ears.
Okay. And while you created this album, what was your biggest inspirations while you're creating this album?
To me, it was ignorance, because, you know, I was 19 years old.
Yes.
I didn't know any better, so all the stuff that I did was, I played off of him, because he was the master musician and producer. So, you know, what he told me, he said, I'm going to build you a pulpit in which you can preach in, and you go into that pulpit and you preach. And I said, okay. So that's his best way of, you know, because what happens is he had to paint a picture that I was familiar with. And the picture that I was familiar with was church. So
with the gospel.
Yeah. So, and plus, you know, thus hence the name D-Train coming over to us as a group, because I was D-Train when I was a football player. And he said, well, why not keep that name for the group as a music? And I said, okay. He said, because the music was powerful and we were trying to create a positive message. And I think we achieved that. I think we've achieved, you know, what we accomplished. We weren't skilled at knowing where it would go and how long it would last, because, you know, most dance music back then came out and, you know, but thank God D-Train is 45 plus years later, still here.
Yes, and so back in time, you didn't want to do funk music, you just want to do something that you have in mind, and to put it on the keyboard and
we didn't call it funk. See, what happens is, you know, he comes from a jazz background. I'm coming from a gospel background. So he knew more about the funk than I did. I didn't grow up listening to funk.
With James Brown or stuff like that, no?
I listened very little to James Brown, more to the Temptations. You know, smooth R&B type of thing.
See, but I came up through James Brown.
Right.
Yes.
Through that, and I used to play drums. Mm-hmm. In the bands, and we used to play all the James Brown songs. Mm-hmm. And we wanted to be like James Brown. We used to, in fact, we would get fined for being late or for playing wrong time and stuff, just like Brave, because we heard James Brown did that. Mm-hmm. So that's what we did. And so I was always into the funk and like dance music. I used to play for dances. So, you know, it's like you, when you ask that question, when did you decide to do the funk music and make the, it was always there. That's
it was
the
natural.
Roots. That's the
natural.
Roots. It's
yes.
Natural, yeah.
Okay. And talking about inspirations, you did some covers in your albums. And now I think of Walk On By, which is a song sung by Dionne Warwick. Mm-hmm. Yes,
yes.
That I love this song, it's incredible.
If you see me walking down the street and I start to cry each time we meet, walk on.
And why this song especially? What do you want to do that?
All I remember was that when he called me up and said we were doing it, he saw it in his sleep. He saw it in a dream. He called me up. It was like, man, I keep seeing this song on ceiling in my dreams, man. I was like, what?
It's true.
It's the truth. And so I'll let you tell the rest.
No, I knew we wanted to do a cover song. And I didn't know what it was, and I just kept trying to figure out what to do. And I was laying up in my bed and looking up at the ceiling, just trying to think of it. And all of a sudden, Walk On By was written on the ceiling. And I said, that's it. And then I started thinking about how could we do it to make it D-Train. And you know, because I was so connected to his spirit, especially by then, I could say, What's the words again? How you started off?
Oh, if you see me walking down the street.
If you see me walking down the street. So I could make, think of the rhythm and then just give him the idea of the rhythm that's already him anyway. Mm-hmm. And then he could take it from there. So, but one thing I must say this, once I give it to him and he gives it back to me, then I can interpret it again and go back to him again. So we go back and forth until it's like this.
And yes, you are the musical part of D-Train, is that right? You play the keyboard, the arrangement.
Production.
Yeah, the production, and you sing the song.
He sings.
No, and he plays.
He plays.
No, see, here's the thing about D-Train. I want people to know.
Yes.
We are musicians, even though he's a singer, but he's a musician as well. He plays guitar. He can play some keyboards. He's a musician.
Incredible.
He just, his strength is his voice.
Yes.
Right? My strength is my musicianship. I can't sing, you know, but...
You didn't sing?
No, I can't. I can't sing a little bit. I can't sing at all.
I wanted to know if there is there an important project or album that never released back in times?
Well, no, you know, the song I remember the most was we were going to do a project in the mid-90s when Jesse Jackson was running for president. And it was called Keep Hope Alive.
Yeah.
And we had samples of Jesse Jackson, Keep Hope Alive, Keep Hope Alive. And you know, it was like, tell the world, listen to the message, keep hope alive. And we were gonna do it, and it was a weird political climate at that time in America. And it just didn't happen because the music industry was changing. Where we were musically, everything had turned into new jack swing. And R&B merged with hip hop. And so instead of wearing decent clothes like what we wear, they, you know, dropped the pants down around the knees and and it just wasn't who we were. And at the time, radio, still being God, it had to go through radio. So even putting that song out, we would have to go to A&R and go through a radio station, which wasn't gonna play it. Plain simple, they're not gonna play it because everything was, you know, the new genre of music, which came into play with Teddy Riley.
And then rap was taken.
Yeah, rap was,
and the rap
well,
music,
rap and R&B merged.
Yeah.
Hip hop and R&B merged, and that was the disaster of R&B because when that happened, you know, that was when most R&B artists started calling women bitches and hoes, you know? And it wasn't like that up until that point. You know, we were trying to earn their trust, earn their love, earn their respect. And then after that, overnight, it just changed. It was like, get on your knees. Yeah. I mean, that's what it turned into. And I couldn't sing nothing like that. I just couldn't. I always told him, if I can't sing it in front of my mother, I don't want to sing it at all.
What do you think about the funk scene, but the actual one nowadays, the funk scene, the modern funk scene?
Well, you know what? In Europe, you guys interpret what was created before you. You grow up on it and you learn from it. Some of you get it, some of you don't, but for the most part, you still respect it. There's a respect for R&B over here that is not so in America. In America is what have you done for me lately? So all of the music that you guys play in the clubs and on the records, we don't get that in America anymore. And what happens is young people who are 25 like yourself in America, they're like, D-Train, what? Who D-Train?
Right, right.
I ain't never heard of D-Train. I caught the train yesterday. You know, they don't even know who Isaac Hayes is or Dionne Warwick. They don't know who Gladys Knight is, because what happens is in America, we've eliminated all of our record stores, which you guys still have. We can't buy vinyl in America. There is no more vinyl. No. Tower Records is closed. Virgin Superstores, all closed. They shut them down all the way across the country. So now the only place in America that most people can go buy their records is Walmart, or Whole Foods, or Target. People go there to buy food. They don't go there to buy records. So our youth and our children, unless they're his kids, yeah, or my kids, or his grandkids and my grandkids, they won't know what we know. They can only learn from us. And yeah, that interpretation has been lost in America because they've shut down every music record store. Not only did they do that, but every music store on 48th Street, which was the mecca for all musicians to buy your instruments, buy your keyboards, your drums, they not only closed it, they demolished it. Closing it wasn't enough. They demolished every music store on both sides of 48th Street so that it would never come back to America.
Well, it's a bit sad.
Bit sad? That's real sad.
Because here in France, especially at Lyon, yeah, the funk is our blood, in our blood. Mm-hmm. There is still in France some record shop to buy vinyls. Right. Vinyls is important.
Yeah, vinyl. Yeah, you can get vinyl in Amsterdam. You know, you got little stores, you have boutique stores. There's still a Virgin Superstore on the Champs-Élysées. Virgin, the big Virgin Superstore in the Champs-Élysées. There's a Virgin Superstore in Amsterdam and in Arnhem. So in those places, music still exists. In Boston, by the Boston Symphony Hall, their students still buy vinyl in Boston, Massachusetts, you know. In New York, it's just gone.
And New York is, oh,
gone.
Now we are for the La Nuit de la Funk. This night, and how long has it been since you were to on stage together?
Probably 30 years, 35, maybe?
Yeah, 35 years, yeah.
When was it the last time? So,
I think 1988.
Yeah, it could be.
With the system.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, 1988. Yeah. When the system came out with Don't Disturb the Screw.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, originally, I was the producer, mm-hmm, and he was the artist. But because he was so young, I had to put the band together because You're the One for Me was the number one song. And all of a sudden, we were like, oh my God, we got a number one song. We need a band. So I had to put the band together of the guys I know who could do it. And once we got in there, I was like, oh, this feels good. I want to be part of the band too. But it was never, I was never supposed to originally be in the band of D-Train. But because of, like I said, because of we had to put the band together, I became part of the band and we became the duo because we did it in the studio.
Yeah. Okay.
So, but my point was, that's why I left later, was because I still wanted to produce and write and do other things too.
So, thank you for taking time to talk with me about funk.
Thank you. I'm glad that somebody as young as you, you know, remembers and keeps our music alive. And, you know, it's just wonderful to see somebody young as yourself, 25 years old, man. How old was
20,
you?
20 years old.
20 years old.
20 years old.
Oh, God.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
I'm 60, man. So, I ain't saying nothing.
I'm 76.
He so wasn't even born then, man.
I really, and I'm sure we really appreciate the people of France, the way that they have given us and showed us love and appreciate the music. And we're glad that we have inspired some people. You know, we're hearing some great stories about how they've been inspired, and that really touches our hearts. We say thank you all.
Thank you.
Yeah, merci beaucoup.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Merci d'avoir regardé l'interview jusqu'au bout. Et si cela vous a plu, vous pouvez vous abonner, partager et liker. Et on se retrouve dans un mois pour un nouvel épisode de Meet & Funk.